here we are, lifting our hands to you. Here we are, giving you thanks for all you do. And as we pray and worship your holy name, you are here, dwelling within our prayer. For every answered prayer, oh yeah, for always being here, for love that hears us when we call, for arms that lift us when we call. Beside us, leading us all along the way, and we made it through. Because of you, and here we are, lifting our hands to you. Here we are. Worship your holy name. You are here, dwelling within our praise. For days we cannot see,
for days we cannot see,
for all that's yet to be,
so much is yet to be.
The trials we may have to face, when we'll be leaning on your grace. Oh yes, it will be your strength, yes it will, that saves. Your love that makes us strong, and
through it all
we'll sing this song. As we pray and worship your holy name, you are here, dwelling within our prayer.
Yes, thank God.
You are here, dwelling within our prayer.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning, it's time to sing. your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy. Your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy. Time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never.
I want to welcome every one of you to this event. As we all know what the barbecue in the park represents to us in Winners Assembly. It is a way of stretching our hands to everyone in the community and spending some good quality time together as families. And as a church, we extend the hand of fellowship as well to our other organizations that are represented today, who are also dealing with alcohol, drug, homelessness, and mental health issues. But we can't start an event like this without praying to God, who has been so good to us. Thank Him for all He's been doing. Thank Him for giving us such a beautiful weather. And thanking Him for bringing good people like you into this meeting today. So I would like to invite one of our pastors in the Redemption Center of God to come and lead us in the opening prayer, and then we'll do some few minutes of praise and worship, and then we can go on to the main event program. So you are most welcome, feel free, enjoy yourself, and let's have a good day in the park. Praise the Lord.
Thank you.
I would like to call on Pastor Blessing, one of the pastors in Winners Tabernacle. The room of have the relief presence of God to give us your name prayer. In Jesus' name. Can we just rise up from our seat and let just glorify the King of all kings, the Ancient of Days, the I Am That I Am, the Alpha and the Omega, the Eloi, the Eshada. Let just stand up on our seat. Even if you are eating, just stand up. Let's stand up and let just begin to glorify the name of the Almighty God. Without Him, we are not going to be here. He's the one that gave us life. He's the one that woke up us this morning. He is the Alpha, he is the Omega, he is the Eloi, he is the Eshada. Without him, he is the bread, he is our vine. There's nothing we own in this life without what he has not given to us. This moment, I want you to take a little bit minute and begin to glorify his holy name. I want you to speak to him quietly from your heart and begin to tell him how important he is to you. For bringing you into this gathering today, it is not by your power, it's not by us as well, it's by his grace and his mercy that he has brought us into his midst this morning, so this afternoon. So I want us to just begin to worship him. We're going to just take a song and we're just going to give him glory. We're going to say, Adonai, we worship you, we worship you, Lord. Son of God, you are so good, Almighty God, hallowed be your name, your dominion is forevermore, forevermore. If you know the song, you can join me. Let's worship God. Let's give him glory. His power is beyond us. He owns the universe. All power belongs to him. Let's give him glory and worship him in his presence this moment. Oh, Lord God, we worship you. Blessed be unto you in heaven. Father, we commit this program into your hand. Father, take control of this service. Oh Lord, you are the Ancient of Days. You own the day, oh Lord the God. Let it be a perfect day in your presence, in the mighty name of Jesus. We take control, we take authority over everything in here today, in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we bless your holy name. Glory be unto you in heaven. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
A very big welcome to you to the 5th annual barbecue, organized solely by the Christian Church of God Winners Assembly Parish. We do this yearly. The first one was beautiful, the second one was big, the third one was bigger, the fourth one, of course, last year was a fantastic event. And this year, which is the 5th edition, is the birth of a new chapter. It's going to be fantastic. And with your presence here, we're expecting a fantastic event. Thank you very much once again for coming. And right now, we're going to kick off with a praise and worship.
You're all together, lovely.
Praise Jehovah. Praise the Elohim. Praise the Elohim. Praise the our Redeemer. Praise our Comforter. We bless you, Jesus. We exalt you, O God. We give you praise, O God. We magnify you, Jesus. Blessed be your name, O God. We worship you, O God. Take all the glory, O God. For in Jesus' mighty name, we
Lord. Ladies and gentlemen, put those beautiful hands together for the choir of the Redeemed Christian Church of God. Winners Assembly here on Brixton Road. Just opposite you there, if you could just turn back. Just turn back, that's the church. You can join us every Sunday morning, 8:30. 8:30 in the morning. The reason we're here is basically for the love of Christ and for the fact that Jesus Christ loves every one of us deeply. Someone once said that there are three most popular names in the world. Three most popular names. What are they? Do you have an idea? He said Michael Jackson. Of course, most people know Michael Jackson from the 80s to the 90s and the early 2000s. Coca-Cola, one of the biggest brands in the world. We know Coca-Cola, but there are quite a number of brands that, rivaling it now. And of course, Jesus Christ. But the fact is today, that is the name that surpasses every other name. And we know, like the good book has said, the only way to the Father is through Jesus Christ. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He's the reason we're doing this and for his love for us. And I'd also like to know our friends around. This event is open to you all. It's open to every one of us. Come, let's fellowship together. Come, let's have a fantastic time. The basic idea behind this is the AD Project. The AD Project stands for Anointing, the Yoke Destroyer, Deliverance, Emmanuel for Eternity. And we have a beautiful personality from the AD Project to give us a presentation. Put your hands together, ladies and gentlemen, for Janice.
He who would valiant be. Let him in constancy follow the master. What men say, we grave. We'll live night and day to be a pilgrim.
Thank you. Oh, beautiful. Beautiful.
Let's appreciate our Councillor, the Mayor of Lambeth, Councillor Donatus, is here with us today. We are welcome to the Redeemed Christian Church of God, the Winners Assembly Parish, Brickstein AD Project Barbecue in the Park, 2015. You are welcome, sir. Enjoy yourself with us and God bless you. Amen. Yes, we are moving on. Please. I want us to key in into these testimonies, you understand? Because whatever you are struggling with God, all things are possible. Speak to somebody here today. And like I said before, this program is transmitted live from heaven. Amen. God is here. Whatever that thing is, that negative situation, God can turn it around to a positive surprise for you. So please, listen to this wonderful testimony for our brother. When I count it from victory accuracy in Jesus' name.
In my inner voice on the dark places. And I'd like to thank Pastor Festus for inviting us and having a really powerful afternoon. Like, this is what a really inner city church should be like. But right now, like, you know, I want to tell you about my testimony. I was a crack addict for nearly 30 years. I thought I was going to die a crack addict. Like, I didn't believe in God. I didn't believe in nothing. But one day I went to the men's home, the victory outreach men's home. I thought to myself, if I go there for 3 months and get clean, I might be able to sell some drugs and make some money. But man has one plan and God has a different plan. So what I'm here to tell you is that it's never too late. It was great to see a young man come up here, because our youth in the street now are suffering. So it's great to see a young man come up here and see God change his life. But what I'm here to tell you is it's never too late. And I met a man named Jesus, and Jesus changed my life. Jesus turned my life around. Jesus has got a plan for each and every one of us here today. He's got a better plan than we could ever imagine. So what I'm here to tell you is, right now, we have to give it over to Jesus. We have to give our life over to God. Because this society is around knowledge. You know, it's around information. It's around technology. Right? But all that thing is taking us to one place. We're suffering. You know, the place is full of depression, mental health problems, drug problems. Right, society can't do nothing about it. God can do something about it. So right now, I'm just here to encourage you today that it's not too late. There is a time for us. God has got a plan for each and every one of us to change our lives, to put us back with our families, to put us back with our children. Because if you look around, families are fighting each other. Children are getting separated from their parents. Brothers and sisters are arguing and fighting with each other. That's not how God meant it to be. That's not how God wants it to be. So if we change our tune, right, and if we go back to how God tells, how your Bible tells us to do it, He will give you back your families. He will give you back your relationship with your children. He will give you back your relationship with your brothers and sisters. And all you have to do is give it over to God. So right now, I've got some cards here today, because we have men's homes, like Teen Challenge has homes. We have homes that accept you virtually straight away. You don't have to go to the council and wait 6 months and 9 months. If you really want to change your life, come and speak to one of the two groups and your life can be changed today. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. I must tell you this, there are loads of testimonies that you're going to be hearing tonight from the horse's mouth, like they say. I would like to quickly recognize the presence of Junie Muhammad. Junie Muhammad is from the NHS Mental Health. Junie Muhammad, thank you very much for taking time out to join us. We really do appreciate your presence here. God bless you. Okay, like you said, most of us are struggling with one form of addiction or the other, and we really do need to get over them. I just want you to know today that God's love transcends all of them. Even in our darkest moments, in our deepest moments, in our private lives, He cuts across it. He sees us. And he can change them. All you have to do is invite him. Just talk to him about it. Talk to him. It's the easiest thing to do. You don't need to get a mobile phone. You don't need to buy airtime. You don't need to call on some therapist to pay. You just speak to him. And he's always there to listen to you. He's just there right beside you. You feel him. He's a beautiful force. Ladies and gentlemen, our children are ready for their presentation. And I want you to graciously put your hands together for the children of the Redeemed Christian Church of God, Winners Assembly.
Hello, parents. We have a beautiful song to sing for you. We hope you enjoy.
Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still water. He restoreth my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and the staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Coming down from the mountain, and is a good shepherd. He's coming down from the heaven. His smile is a good shepherd. He's coming down from where I was. He's a good shepherd. He's coming down. It's coming down from the heavens. Amen.
Thank you.
Fire follow me in my life, Holy Ghost fire. Fire follow me in my life, Holy Ghost fire.
and gentlemen, let's appreciate Sonny and friends.
But woe to him who is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him up. The good book also says that one will chase 1,000, but two will chase 2,000. We could work together and make it work. Ladies and gentlemen, we'd still like to recognize the presence of the Mayor of Lambeth in our midst. So we thank you so much for taking time out to join us. He is Councillor Donatus Anyanwu, and he will be coming up pretty soon to give us his keynote address. But before then, we'd like to share another testimony from Victory Altruism. Put your hands together for him, please.
Good afternoon. My name is Paul. I came to Victory Outreach 4 years ago. I arrived in the UK year 2000, 15 years ago. By the time 2009, from husband, from hardworking man, from businessman, I ended up on the streets. Almost 2 years I spent living on the streets. It got so bad that at the end I had to smoke heroin before I can have a drink. But that would not stop me. When one day I wake up and said, is that all? Is that all that it is to life? And I thank God that in my way I met Victory Outreach. And in Victory Outreach I met God. Because only by His grace, I know by His mercy, no one else could change me. My missus couldn't change me. Police couldn't change me, courts couldn't change me, my children couldn't change me. Nothing could change me except from God. So I thank God for my salvation. I thank for ministries like Victory Outreach, like Teen Challenge who work. And if you've got any issues or you know somebody who needs help, come to see one or other organization. We give you a flyer, we give you a contact, and we will help you out. Because the same grace what we have in our lives, we have to give to other people. Same what God's done in our lives, we have to do the same work to other people today. So I really encourage, don't suffer in silence. God already forgiven whatever you've done. It's never too late. No matter what you've done, God already forgiven to you. So all you need to do, just make that one step today. And I encourage, don't be shy, just come to see us. We've been there, we've done it. We were worse of the worst. And look what God has done in our life. We've got families back, we've got children back, we've got our parents back. So I really encourage you, come and see us today, and you can see what God's done in our lives, and He's going to do exactly the same in your life. Amen.
We are all aware of the presence of our mayor here today, and I would like to invite the mayor, Councillor Donatus, to come and give his keynote. Please, let's appreciate him as he comes on. You're welcome, sir.
Thank you very much. All the testimonies and the singing, other from the children, all these wonderful voices, I don't really know how I'm going to follow that up. Pastor, friends, families, children, thank you very, very much for your invitation. I am absolutely honored to be here with you this afternoon with the understanding of the good work you have been doing in our community. I know you've been going since 2004. And then within that, you've been helping individuals who have got alcohol and drug issues. You have been feeding our homeless. You have supporting individuals with mental health. And you have always, always been the hand that supports individuals when they are absolutely down. As a mayor of Lambeth, I thank you very much. Our borough is a borough that actually based strongly in various faiths. We are a faith borough, and I tell you why I say we are a faith borough. This borough is where the Archbishop of Canterbury lives. This borough is where the Bishop of Southwark lives. This borough is a borough where during the Reformation, a lot of those individuals who are absolutely very strong in their faith absolutely come to escape from persecution. Also, we are a borough, if the people don't know, who actually started the emancipation of the slaved human beings. The Clapham sect, Clapham not far from here, was a religious strong faith organization. They were the first people who said slavery is absolutely terrible. They were a faith organization who started helping those individuals who have been enslaved to see the light. It's when they started the liberation of those individuals, Mr. Wilberforce came into them. And also they changed absolutely the slave owner who ended up writing Amazing Grace through their faith, they changed that individual. So you are in the right place as a faith organization. Working with us, helping those individuals most vulnerable, making individuals to see themselves in the faith they belong to and become stronger and stronger. Again, I'll thank you. The partnership you have established with various organizations is also a testimony of how good you've been to us. As a mayor, I looked around, I know there are heroes, some of our people who have made progress in life. We also have some of our people who are absolutely despair and to the point of no return. People like you who have your food bank, who have the day-to-day feeding of those individuals who are vulnerable, including the social workers, mental health people, you belong to that heroes. You are those people who I call heroes, not those people who are in the top like myself. Because it's when you are down, you are the ones holding those people's hand, lifting them up, helping them to climb and come back, as I've seen the testimonies that I've had today. With that, and I'll say to you, continue the journey. Hopefully, we will be in that journey with you. Hopefully, you and us will be working together, making sure those individuals who need support will be there. And as individuals with faith, you actually breaking a certain bond, making sure that people grow and stop reoffending. Making sure young people will not use their hands to harm another person. Making sure our adults absolutely make sure that their children are in the right place. Again, my gratitude to you and thank you very much. Hopefully, I will continue coming and supporting you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, put those wonderful hands together for Councillor Donatus Ayau. Thank you very much, sir, and he'll be taking his leave pretty soon. We also like to let you know that we'll be looking forward to many more events like this and you come in and, you know, making it beautiful with your fantastic presence. Thank you very much, sir. Okay, before I call on our youth to come give the presentation, ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to recognize the presence of Pastor Tunde Fayebumi from Faith Chapel, Catford, is here with us. Thank you very much, sir. You can take a bow. And also Pastor Stephen Bailo from Chatham in Kent is also here with us. Thank you, sir. Thank you for coming. So now let's put our hands together. I believe in children our future. The late Whitney Houston would say, they are our future. They're beautiful, they're talented, they're everything, everything. Beautiful, I would say still. Let's put our hands together for our youth as we welcome them to give us their fantastic presentation.
Oh,
Beautiful. Let's appreciate the youth, please. Ladies and gentlemen, we can do better than that.
Yes, yes, yes.
Let's appreciate the young ones, the upcoming stars, the superstars, the next generation. Amen. For the benefit of those of you who don't know, this is the AD project of the Redeemed Christian Church of God, the Winners Assembly Parish, Bristol. If you look behind you from where you are seated, that's the church there, the church with the yellow board on top of it. The AD Project, we meet every Saturday from 2 o'clock to 5 every Saturday. We mentor people with drug and alcohol problems. And we help the homeless as well. Then from Monday to Fridays, we meet 12 noon to 3 p.m. You know, we fellowship together. If you have any problem and if you have the time, come and let's fellowship together. And I would like to encourage everyone here, for those of us who are struggling with one addiction or the other, like drug, alcohol, we have our partners here with us. The Teen Challenge are here. It's a Christian organization as well. They help people, they offer that thing, that anointing, that grace that is upon them for you to break off from that drug and alcohol problems. Amen. And we'll have the Victory Outreach as well. Amen. So please, ladies and gentlemen, let's use this opportunity that we have here today. Because I'm telling you again, this program is being transmitted live from heaven. Because God is here. Amen. So we are here again. Today is a special day. And please, don't be in a hurry to go because we have loads of food to eat. Amen. We have jollof fries, we have chicken, we have burgers and everything. But before then, we have a wonderful performance here for you people. Our friend and our artist, his name is Emmanuel the Magnificent and his group, they are here for us today. Please, let's welcome them as they come in, please. Let's welcome the Emmanuel the Magnificent as they come in, please. God bless you. Amen.
take it away. Thank you.
here. I know him. I've seen him several times. So listen, I'm going to go get... I just met your husband.
My husband is there.
And it was not easy, but 8 years later, I am standing here in front of you. I am standing here because of the grace of God. Do you know what that word grace means? It means God's unearned, undeserved, unmerited favor. You know, I was able, when I was on the streets, to skim my way, to buy my way through a lot of things. But if there was only one thing I could not buy my way through, it was my salvation. Because salvation is a gift from God. You cannot earn it, you cannot buy it. It is a gift you can only receive. And then I had to come to a place where I had to raise my hands up and said, Father God, I cannot do it my way anymore. You know, I'm tired, I'm sick and tired of that lifestyle. I want to stop doing it my way and begin to do it your way. And incredible things happened. And Jesus came into my life. Jesus set me free 8 years ago. So this is why I'm standing here today. I know you must know this scripture. It is one of the well-known scripture in the Bible. John 3:16. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believed in him will not perish but have everlasting life. So what I want to do is to break down that scripture to you, to give you an understanding of what God was saying. When it says that for God so loved the world, it means that God is a people person. God loves you this afternoon, regardless of what you might be going through. God so loves you. Do you know why he so loved you? Because he made the ultimate sacrifice. He gave his only son. Have you ever had anybody to die for you? I've never had anybody to buy die for me before, apart from Jesus. You know, Jesus gave it all up because he loved me. You know, he paid the price for me at the cross at Calvary 2,000 years ago. God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believes in him today. Now, I don't know what you believe in. I'm not here to judge you this afternoon.
You see, that same passion, desire, that fervency I have for drinks and drugs, you know, I now have that passion to reach out to the lost. You know, anybody who is bold enough, anybody who has not had a relationship with Jesus this afternoon, the time is right now. You know, you could enter into a relationship with him. And I have no doubt the Spirit of the Lord is right there right now. The Bible says when two or three are gathered in his name, he is in our midst right now. Jesus wants to meet with you. Jesus wants to have a relationship with you. Jesus wants to fellowship with you. Jesus wants to set you free from darkness, from bondage, whatever it might be, the addiction. You know what I mean? He wants to enter into this relationship with you. But remember the time Brother Thompson preached the word? What did you do with the message of hope? What did you do with that message of salvation? You cannot say to God, I was not ready yet, because that will be too late. Your time is now. It is right now. Is there anyone in this place right now who does not know Jesus as his Lord or Savior, as your Lord and Savior this afternoon? If there is anybody who does not know him, I want to give you this opportunity. I want you to just to come forward this afternoon. You can come forward right there and right now, you know, to enter into a relationship with him this afternoon. The goodness of God leads to salvation this afternoon. Salvation is a gift from God. You know what I mean? God is not going to force himself upon you. He wants to give you this opportunity. Is there anyone? Is there anyone right now? I need to make sure before I come off that mic. Because when I walk away from here, the choice is yours this afternoon. But God loves you. You know, he wants to meet with you. He wants to have relationship. He wants to have fellowship with you this afternoon. But then it has got to be first things first. You know, you need to acknowledge him. You know her, develop a friendship with her, and today we are married. You know, it's just the same way like having a relationship with God. You know what I mean? He is the first person you turn to when you wake up in the morning. He is the same person you turn to in the middle of the day. You could either choose life, or you could either choose death this afternoon. You know, he's not going to force himself upon you. Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door. If you open the door this afternoon, he wants to come in and dine with you. He wants to have fellowship with you. He longs to have a personal and intimate relationship with you this afternoon. I want to just ask you a simple question to everybody in the audience today. And I'm not trying to scare you. If you were to die right now, and don't get me wrong, I'm not saying you'll die right now. Do you know where you'd be going to? This is a key question.
This afternoon. But in closing, I want to say to you this afternoon, without him, there is no way. You know, he is the only way. Jesus is the only way. Jesus is the truth. Jesus is the light this afternoon. You know, the choice is yours. I want to thank you this afternoon for this opportunity to minister to you. And remember that Jesus loves you. It is not a conditional love, it's an unconditional love. You know what I mean? He proved it to you. God proved his love to us by allowing his son to die on the cross. So I want you to think, when I go off, you know, what are you doing with what Jesus has done for you at the cross at Calvary? You know, that's the key question. Where are you going? Life's most important question. Who am I? Where do I come from? And where are you going to? These are questions you need to ask yourself this afternoon. All right, enjoy. Bless you.
Thank you very much, sir. God bless you. To develop a relationship with Christ is one of the most beautiful things. As a matter of fact, it is the most beautiful thing on planet Earth right now. Ladies and gentlemen, we are the pick of the event, and of course I can say that the food has been going round, but guess what, there is more to come, because we still have our main dish of jollof rice. You cannot afford to attend a Nigerian party or event without having jollof rice. It is famous around the world, but there is this debate about who does it right, the Nigerians, the Gambians, the Sierra Leoneans. Believe me, it's the Nigerians, and you're in the right place for that. We have many performances, and of course the testimonies will be coming up pretty soon. And I would love for you to put your hands together for this lovely lady. She's been partnering with us. She's been helping people. Junie Mohammed, she's from the NHS Mental Health. Put your hands together for this lovely lady. Thank you.
I come to inspire. I'm from South London and Maudsley. And this afternoon, what we're going to do is we're going to look at stress. So those of you who are a little bit far away, come a little bit nearer. Help me feel inspired. Come a little bit nearer. Okay. Anybody here that has never felt stress? One person. Most people feel stressed, don't they? Yeah? What does stress look like? What does it look like? Is it when we're shouting? I need a little microphone in the audience, please. Is it when we're shouting? Crying? When we can't sleep? When we feel irritable? Somebody's saying something at the back and I can't hear.
All of that.
I said, I'm damn right. Did he say that? Okay. When we feel anxious, sometimes we eat too much and sometimes we eat too little. Stress is like a secret killer. We need some stress, don't we? We need some stress, but not too much. And not too long. Yeah? Stress can affect your body. When you feel stressed out, who gets a headache? Some people get headaches, some people get rashes, some people get constipation or diarrhea, pains in their body, palpitations. Some of us get really angry. Especially our men and our children can get very angry. So stress doesn't always look the same in everybody. We all get stressed. Even our children experience stress. And they are stressed. They can be stressed from in the womb. And that is why we always honor our mothers and we take care of them in their pregnancy. That the babies are not stressed. True? That the mother can have a safe pregnancy. So one of the things that we need to begin to do, what do we do when we begin to feel stressed? What are some of the things we can do? Did we get that microphone? Nobody's listening. It's here? Okay. Can we begin to do when we start to recognize stress? Because stress on its own is one thing, but when stress turns to distress and it triggers illness in the body, that's when a lot of us get into trouble. And some of the men that gave a testimony earlier, a very powerful testimony about their journey. Often when we're stressed, we want more alcohol, we want more tobacco, we want more drugs, we eat more sugary foods. True? And that's how we often manage stress. But that is not necessarily the best way to handle stress, because it makes the stress worse, as many of the testimonies have said here before. So what I want us to think about, when we're stressed, who tells you you're stressed? And how do you know that you are stressed? When you start to find yourself reacting very sharp with people, you start to know you're stressed. When you start to lose patience with people, you know you're stressed. When you can't help shouting at people, you know
you are stressed. When you can't get a good night's sleep, you know you're stressed. This is the time when we need to start to doing what? What's the first thing we can begin to do? We need to start to eat right. That a lot of people don't explain. Some of the symptoms and illnesses produced by stress, because stress produces a hormone called cortisol. Have you heard of cortisol before? Cortisol is a hormone. And when it's elevated, when you're stressed out, it can trigger your body to have too much sugar. It will trigger your body to store too much fat. And as a result, many of us suffer with diabetes. You're storing fat and you don't want to store the fat. It can make you feel dizzy and have respiratory problems. So stress is dangerous because it makes your hormones go out of balance. So the reason why you enjoy praise and worship, because it reduces the stress in your body. It produces your happy hormones. It makes you feel grounded and balanced. So when we do things that we enjoy and we feel that we belong and we do our best to eat right and get some good sleep and exercise, that allows us to begin to manage the stress in our body. Please, don't ignore stress signs in your body. It is very dangerous. Many of you have the power to begin to manage your own stress and do the things that make you feel more calm and relaxed. But before I go, just one last word. I've got 7 stress fighting weapons. We need to breathe. We have to relax, because that creates a lot of tension because we're not breathing properly. We need to be mindful, and some of you are already doing mindfulness, or you can have mindfulness happening at your projects. Yoga is very good. Tai Chi, getting in balance with your heart. And that's where a lot of us today are people of faith. You pray and you worship. That's how you get your balance. And learn something new. We're never too old to learn. And it's really good for us. And the last thing I will say to you is, make sure whatever you do, sleep well. Sleep well. And on that note, I'm going to say thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, that was a powerful presentation from our sister, our friend, our partner. Let's appreciate her one more time. Junie Muhammad. Ma'am, you are welcome. Thank you very much for your time. Are we happy today? Hello? Let somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let somebody shout hallelujah. Amen. Yes. This program is being transmitted live from heaven. Amen. God is here. Yeah? So we are proceeding now. This is the AD Project. We meet every Saturday from 2 to 5. For those of you who don't know our location, it's right behind you. If you turn around, you see where that yellow board is. Where that yellow board is. That place is a sanctuary. It's a refuge for everyone. You understand? You can come in there from 2 to 5 every Saturday. You can come in there from 2 to 5 every Saturday. Come and fellowship with us. And come and eat some jollof rice and chicken. Amen. Then Monday to Fridays, we have our soup kitchen. It's called the Shade UK. Amen. We open from 12 noon to 3 p.m. Amen. And it's been a wonderful experience here today. I would like to use the opportunity to acknowledge the presence of our beautiful partners, a friend, a sister, and a mentor. Please, ladies and gentlemen, let's recognize our beautiful sister, Sister Catherine Mosini from Divine Rescue. Let somebody shout hallelujah. She's not shy anyway, so that's why she's waving her hand. Amen. And I would like to acknowledge the presence of a friend, a sister. Her name is Pastor Gwen from the Rich Ministry. Let's appreciate her life for Jesus Christ. Let somebody shout hallelujah. Are we happy today? Please, I want you guys to speak to someone. If you know you are struggling with drug and alcohol addiction, speak to me. I'm the project manager of the AD project. But maybe if you may not feel comfortable talking to me, you can speak to the team challenge. They are here. The victory athletes are here. Do something. Make a decision. Yes, we have a wonderful guest in our midst today. She's a beautiful lady. She's a musician. And she's anointed. Please, ladies and gentlemen, join me to welcome Claire B. Dunset as she comes forward. Let's appreciate her. Amen.
Are you happy to be here today?
The sun's over that way, so why are you sitting this way? The sun behind you, special exposure on that side.
My name is Claire B. Dunset. Right now I'm going to sing my single, which is You Are. The song says, You are the Lord of Lords. You are my strength. And you are worthy of my praise. So this is my first single, it's already out now.
My prayer.
the Lord of Lords. He is my strength and is worthy of my praise. Are you happy with the song? He is the Lord of Lords and is worthy of my praise. It's not a song, it's easy. You are the Lord of Lords, my love, my strength. You are beyond my praise. You are the Lord of Lords. I repeat, my name is Claire B-Donzet, D-O-N-Z-E-T. You can find me on Facebook, on all social media. So now we're gonna dance. This is not my song, but we're gonna dance on that song. And I want you to help me sing that song, okay? I think a lot of people know that song. You know? When Jesus says yes, nobody can say no. When Jesus says yes, nobody can say no. Can you do that? Thank you. Hey! 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 Come on, clap your hands! Hey! 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 When Jesus say yes, nobody can say no. Hey! When Jesus say yes, nobody can say no. I've been worried about a thing, 'cause I know you are guiding me. When you leave me alone, I will go. I'm a fear, 'cause I know who in control. There's no limit to what you can do. Yes, it all belongs to you. Holding on to you, God Almighty, hold power of God. Yes, it's holding on to you. Hey, when Jesus say yes, nobody can say no. When Jesus say yes, nobody can say no. I'm the world by the thing, 'cause I know you are guiding me. When you leave me alone, I will go. I'm a fish, 'cause I know who's in control. There's no limit to what you can do. Yes, it all belongs to you. All belongs to you. God Almighty, hold power for. Yes, it all belongs to you. Hey! When Jesus say yes, nobody can say no. 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 Truth is no limit to what you can do. There's no belong to you. Hold it on to you, God Almighty. Hold on, work for. Yes, it all belongs to you. Yeah. To what you can do. Yes, it all belongs to you. Hold it on to you, God Almighty. Hold on, work for. Yes, it all belongs to you. When Jesus say yes, nobody can say no. 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 When Jesus say yeah. When Jesus say yeah. Woo. Woo.
So when our sister was saying we should dance so that God and his angels can smile, you know, God bless you. Let's clap our sister Claire, please. That was a wonderful presentation. Amen.
Yes.
I would like to call forward one of our partners to give a testimony. Victory Outreach. I don't know the Victory Outreach. This opportunity to bring forward our friend, one of our mentors, the way forward. I'm talking about Mr. Steve himself, a gentleman, a young man, he's anointed, he's great. Let's welcome Mr. Steve, the way forward. Praise the Lord.
Yes, can you all hear me? Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Steve Rowland from Way Forward. Okay, Way Forward. Way Forward is a ministry. I'm working with prisoners. Way Forward is a ministry working with prisoners and their families, and also working to prevent young people from going to prison. Did you know that in the UK that there's an overrepresentation of black people within our prisons that is worse than the United States? Did you know that? It is worse than the United States here in the UK. Did you know that we have 150,000 children in this country as a family member in prison? Did you know that we have over 85,000 people in prison? And for young people, when they come out of prison, did you know that 80%, that's 8 out of 10 of them, will go back to prison? 8 out of 10 will go back to prison. That tells you that there's something wrong with the system. In addition to that, did you know that the Christian faith within our prisons is declining? Is declining. Did you know that the Christian faith within our prisons is declining? Whilst over the last 12 years, the Muslim faith has doubled within our prison system in this country. So, I'm going to tell you a little bit about Way Forward and how it was birthed. It was birthed out of my own personal journey, my own journey of faith. Before I became a Christian, I was very anti-Christian. I was very anti-Christian. The stumbling block for me used to be Jesus. Jesus was my stumbling block. It didn't make any sense to me. This whole thing about the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, for me, it was foolishness. It was foolishness. But how can one and three be the same? It made no sense. Jesus didn't make any sense to me. So on my spiritual search, I searched everywhere except Christ. And my journey took me to becoming a part of the Nation of Islam, searching through Egypt and all of those things, and also took me into witchcraft. But at the time, when I say witchcraft, for me, I didn't believe it was witchcraft. At the time, I believed that what I was worshipping was the true God, because I could see the power of that working, and I used to think that there was no power in the church, because I didn't see any power in the church. So to cut a long story short, I ended up in prison, in Wandsworth prison. And whilst I was there, I went to the Bible study. And my only reason for going to the Bible study was to give the Christians a hard time, because they used to take pleasure in giving Christians a hard time and telling them this Jesus thing is foolishness and all of that. So whilst I was there, I messed up the Bible study, and then after that, a couple of guys started to talk to me about some of the things that I was talking about in that Bible study. And they seemed to know what I was talking about. So I said to them, did you guys understand what I was saying in there? And they said, yes. I said, are you guys Christians? And they said, yes. So I said, you need to explain to me how you can be Christians and understand some of the things I was talking about. So we didn't have time, we were getting banged up in the prison cells. They told me to read the first three books of John. And if I had any questions, to speak to them the next day in the yard. I did that. And then as I was speaking to them, they seemed to have answers. But I was still skeptical. I said, okay, I wrote down the answers and I said, tonight, when I'm in my prison cell, I'm going to check it out in my Bible, just to see what they're saying. So that night, when I was in my prison cell, and I was reading the Bible with their answers alongside, just to check it out, what happened? I needed to know more about this Jesus. So to cut a long story short, I went through that journey and I spent a long time in prison. I was in there for almost 7 years as a Christian, but was built up in my faith. Now the problem while I was there, I used to see people leaving the prison and coming back again. I used to see people leaving, having made a commitment to the Christian faith, and still come back. And when I used to ask them why they come back, the story that I got the most was that they tried to integrate, they tried to find a place in the church, but they felt they were being judged and they weren't being cared for, and they dropped out of the church, they went back to their normal lifestyle and ended up back in prison. So it was on the back of that why we started Way Forward Ministries. And it's a way that we can support people when they come out of prison, support them not only with their practical needs, but also with their spiritual needs.
He said, I will blot out your transgression for his own sake, not for your sake. So when God forgives, he forgets. Amen. And I would like you guys to key in to this event today. If you know by any chance, maybe you know somebody in your family, a friend, a neighbor, a cousin, maybe your mom, your dad, that is struggling with drug addict.
I'll tell you a little bit about myself and how that all started about. I was born in Glasgow. I haven't got a Scottish accent anymore because my mum moved us down here when we were young. I was in foster care when I was 2 years old, which was quite a horrific experience. I was abused by my foster carers. So from a very early age, I had a hatred towards anyone in authority, any sort of foster carers, social services, anybody like that. When I was 5, my mum got us out of foster care and moved us down to London. When we got to London, we were homeless. We had nowhere to go, and we were just living on the streets. And then the social services there got us into some hotels, and we were homeless for about a year or two. And then we got a flat in Bethnal Green, which is the place that I was brought up on for the next 15 years of my life. So I went to school. I had a really bad squint when I was younger. My left eye used to like squint inwards. And so I've come to London now at 5 years old. I've got a squint in my eye and a Scottish accent. The kids in school didn't really like that very much, so they kind of bullied me a little bit. I was quite a quiet kid. I was quite timid, you know, and so people bullied me. I shied away from it. I kind of hid from them. My mum was a chronic alcoholic. She was a very violent woman, very violent Scottish woman. She used to beat my sister, beat me. So from a very early age, I was kind of oppressed at home and I was oppressed at school. And I just kind of went into myself. I learned to how to run away from situations and you know, run away from confrontation and hide. And, you know, so things went on like that until I was about 13 years old. Now, when I was 13, I started to wonder what it would be like to drink that stuff that my mum drank, that vodka. So I had a little experiment and I tried some of it. And when it started to affect me, I started to think, wow, I've kind of found the meaning of life here, man. This is what it's all about. It took away all my fears, all my trepidations, you know, everything that I thought I was, it taught me I wasn't. And it gave me confidence. I wasn't a confident kid. So I started being this confident kid, and I went back to school, and the bullies still tried to bully me. And so after school I'd go and get drunk, and I'd go around their houses and I'd bully them, and I started to make a bit of a name for myself. I got caught up in stealing cars when I was 14 years old. The first car I stole, I took a chase off the police. The police caught me and they gave me a severe kicking. They beat me within an inch of my life. And so from a young age again, I had a real passion to hate the police. I had a real passionate hatred towards them, and I hated them. So I'm growing up now, I hate foster carers, I hate authority, I hate police, you know, and I found alcohol. And alcohol's given me the confidence to do all these things. So I carried on stealing cars because I knew it annoyed the police. And I used to do crazy things. I'd be driving down the road in a stolen car, and I'd see a police car, and I'd run straight into the side of it just to get the chase. Quite often I'd get caught, end up in prison. I drove into a police forecourt one time, the front of the police station, and I'm there and I'm bibbing the horn, and my friend's jumped out, and he's out and he's making all sorts of hand signals and swearing, until the police come out and chase us off down the road. That particular event ended up with the car being on its roof. We went off a bridge, on its roof, in a river, destined to die. Two policemen pulled me out of they got into the water, they pulled me out of the wreckage, and I've still got this hatred towards them. As they're dragging me out of the car, I've got a mouth full of water, and as they pulled me out through the water, I spat in the cop's face, because I hated them that much. So things went on like that for a long time. I ended up going to prison, I don't know, maybe 20, maybe 25 times. So my life up to 27 was just in and out of prison, you know, stealing cars, being a complete idiot, and, you know, hating the police, hating authority, hating everybody. My mum died when I was 27 years old. By this time I had a 3-year-old daughter, and I got involved obviously with her mum. We'd moved in together. Sarah was a lovely girl. She was about 10 years younger than me. And when my mum died, I had a friend who used to take heroin. I used to see the state that he used to get. I used to think, you know, where is that place that he's going to? What's it all about? So now when my mum died, I thought, you know, that place that he gets himself to seemed quite attractive to me. So I thought, you know, I want to get to that place, because I was hurting. I was really hurting inside, and I didn't know where to turn. So I turned to this drug addict. You know, I bought him some drugs, he bought me some, and and, you know, the feeling, I'm not going to deny it, it was nice. You know, and it took me to a place that I wanted to get to. You know, within 2 weeks, I was injecting it into my veins. I was sticking needles in myself. Within a couple of more weeks, I was on a crack pipe. I was smoking crack. So I'm now addicted to alcohol, I'm addicted to heroin, I'm addicted to crack. Everything's going wrong. Me and my girlfriend, we just got a flat together, our 3-year-old's in there. It ain't an environment for a 3-year-old to be in. So social services inevitably got involved. you know, and I hated them with a passion, as I've told you. Things didn't change for me and the girlfriend. My girlfriend ended up on the drugs, you know, because she saw me doing it. She wanted to get into the place that I was getting in. She ended up on drugs as well. Chelsea got taken into foster care. And I remember the time when the foster carers came to me, the social services came to me, and they said, Colin, they said, we want to come and meet these foster carers. And I'm like, I don't want to meet any foster carers. I want my daughter back. And in the same sentence, the social services said, yeah, they're lovely people, you know. I said, they're not lovely, they're foster carers, you know, they're idiots. She said, yeah, and, you know, the man's a policeman. And that made it even worse. So I said, oh, I'll meet them. Of course I'll meet them, all right. I wanted to go in there as a social service, and I wanted to kill these two people. They got my daughter. They're, you know, the guy's a copper. I hated coppers, and they're foster carers, who I hated from 2 years old. I wanted to kill these people. I absolutely detested them. So I've walked into the social services office, and as I've gone into the room, and these two people have stood over in the corner, I just got engulfed in this peace that at the time I could not understand what it was, where it had come from. But I walked in the room and I had this peace. I got to talking to them, and you know, there was no violence. I didn't want to fight anymore. I didn't want to beat them up anymore. I kind of knew that my daughter Chelsea was in safe hands. And a couple of more meetings, I met a couple of more times, they started to tell me about Jesus and about the love of God. And, you know, all this stuff, it didn't make any sense to me. I thought they were crazy, but I couldn't deny the peace that I felt in my heart when they were telling me this stuff. When I was in their presence, they were telling me about Jesus, and I was like, this is completely, you know, backwards to what I know life to be about. I couldn't deny the peace. Anyway, we left there. Nothing changed. Me and Sarah, we continued on our self-destruct mode. We were both on drugs, both injecting heroin. By this time, Sarah started to inject into her groin because she had no veins. Cut a long story short, Sarah got really ill one day from injecting into her groin. She went into hospital. The hospital phoned me out. They said, Colin, you need to come to the hospital now. I went to the hospital. They said, you know, Sarah's passed away. She died from septicemia. Blood. Now, at this time, we've got a five-year-old daughter. You know, my mum's just dying. She's in foster care. I'm completely lost. I don't know what to do. I haven't got a clue. My life from that point just spirals out of control. I had to tell Chelsea about her mum. Her mum's dead. When I told her about her mum being dead, you know, there was a sort of... She was gutted. She was devastated. Of course she was. But it was almost as though she was expecting it. It was almost as though she knew something was going to happen. And at that point, I realised I can't look after Chelsea, so Chelsea got adopted. Well, a few of you may know that that's a Bible scripture, but to me at the time, it meant a lot to me at the time, because the 29/11 is my birthday. 29/11/1979. At the moment, which I now know to be the Holy Spirit, he dropped Teen Challenge into my head. And I remember I had one of these cards in my wallet. It had been there for about 3 years. I pulled it out. And I run down the road as fast as I could, past all the offer licenses, straight into probation, and I run Teen Challenge. Within 2 weeks, I was in Teen Challenge. I got in there, they're all in there, they're all worshipping the Lord, and hands in the air, and I thought, you know, this lot are an absolute bunch of nutters. What am I doing here? But something kept me there. The love that I felt off of the guys that were there. Dunstan, the guy that gave me the word earlier, he's one of the leaders there. He's been a great mentor to me. You know, I thought the guy was a complete lunatic when I first met him. You know, a few of you here today might think he's a bit nuts when he was going about doing his thing here. He's the most sane man I know to be on this earth right now. You know, that love that I sensed off the foster carers and the copper in the social services was the same love that I got from T, which I later became to love of Jesus Christ. When I realised that it was from Jesus, I gave my life at City Gates Christian Centre in Ilford. And that was 2 years ago, and I haven't looked back since. Jesus has come into my life, he's come into my heart, he's completely changed my life. He's restoring the relationship with my daughter who's in foster care, and he's restored my life. And, you know, if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Saviour, you know, if you're too embarrassed to come up and give your life in front of all these people, find someone from the church, go into the church, you know. I've got cards in my pocket I can give you if you've got a drug or an alcohol issue. You know, don't let pride get in the way. You know, if you've got an issue and you need to deal with it, because it will hold you down and it will oppress you for the rest of your life. Praise God.
Can we all stand up and let's pray? Let's pray for him. Just say something.
pray for him, please. For a minute, just pray for this young man, because God has inspired me so much. Let's pray for him, please.
In Jesus' name we pray. Our Father and our God, we bless and we thank you. Lord, you are the Almighty, the maker of all things. Father, we pray that this I believe there is more. I believe.
wrote that song when I was a baby, so they are remixing it for everybody today. Go on then. That was beautiful. Don't worry, I'll give you some chicken and the love fries takeaway as you are going. Let's appreciate them. Let's clap for these children. You can go now. High five again one more time. Yeah? God bless you. God bless you. Good, good, good. Let's appreciate these wonderful children. Yes, it's getting better and better for us. Yeah, for the past years now, we'll be having some wonderful people in our midst on Saturdays, even on Mondays. I don't know if our sister Vadal can come forward. Let's appreciate our sister as she comes forward. Praise the Lord. Give your testimony and let the name of the Lord be glorified.
My testimony is not so long as everyone else. But anyway, when I became homeless, yeah, this is only about 9 years ago, the devil was trying to tell me I must chuck away my life. And I said, but hold on a minute, my skin is too good for the River Thames. Hello? So Jesus Christ came into my life. And it's really, 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 really nice. Since then, I've passed all my exams. Everything they put me through, I passed. Even though they said this about me, even though they said that about me, I still came out tops because Jesus got a purpose for me here in this planet, and I'm here to do His will, okay? And as I said, I am not going to be stepping down because Jesus Christ put me here for a purpose. So let's lift up your hand to say, I'm glad that I'm in Jesus Christ. He's been with me from the day I born, and He will be with me even when I'm gone. Yeah, He is wonderful. Even from a child, He didn't deceive me. My mom or my dad told me I couldn't read and I can't write. But for someone who couldn't read and who can't write, I actually passed all my levels of whatever education they put me through. My mental health, I still got problems with my mental health, but God has still got purpose for me in this world. You're not ashamed, because Jesus has a purpose for us all. I give thanks for His life, and thank You for everything what's happened, whether good or bad. My Jesus, He doesn't fail me. Where my mum and my dad to thank me. As a little girl, they said, let's get all right. They kicked me out of school, and I've been up and down, hello? Didn't know what to do. I was running around the streets, doing things what I shouldn't supposed to be doing, okay? Got a problem with the law, yeah? It's not a shameful thing to do, but at the end of the day, I managed to find, because I praise the God, I find the strength to turn around my life. So, as I said, there's always faith in Jesus. Wherever you do, whatever has happened to you, there's Jesus Christ listening to you. Yeah? By the name of Jesus, as I said, I want to show you one illustration of my life, what it has been. And thank you, Lord. Anybody would like to have a look at this? This is a true life story about myself, yeah? If you like to look, don't feel free to come and have a look. It's about me, what I've managed to do after I've lost my flat, lived on the street for 6 months, crying, feeling weak and everything. But by Christ Jesus Lord, He came down from heaven and He took me up in His bosom and took me, led me to a nice safe place where I could rest my head at night. Because I prayed to my Lord, I've repented for 2 weeks to ask for forgiveness of anything I've done wrong so that I can get a perfect way, so that I can lead the way and get into Christ Jesus Lord. I would not give up in Jesus' name. I would not give up in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's appreciate Jesus for the life of our sister. That was a powerful one. That was a powerful testimony. And ladies and gentlemen, please, don't be in a hurry to go. We have lots of food there for you people. And I would like to use this opportunity to appeal to you guys. If you know you are here today and there's something, you have a friend, a brother, a sister,
that is struggling with issues with drugs. It may be something else. Please do not hesitate to speak to the Teen Challenge or the Victory Outreach or even the Divine Rescue.
Let us pray, please. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just want to say a big thank you to you for today. Lord, we thank you for this wonderful project. We thank you, Lord, for the start of the whole thing. We thank you for how far you have taken the project. And we thank you for where you are taking it to. Blessed be your holy name in Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you for every soul that has been converted since this project started. For the lives that are being reached, lives that are changing, lives that are being transformed. Father, we give you all the glory. We say thank you in Jesus' name. Lord, even as we bring this program to a close tonight, Father, we ask that as we go, that you go before us and you go with us in Jesus' name. Daddy, guide our steps. Let it be well with us. Everyone that has contributed in one way or the other to make this program a success. But I will pray that in their lives, you will give them good success in Jesus' name. We give you all the glory and the honor. We pray, Lord, that through this project, many more souls shall be won to your kingdom. Lord, every money that has been spent today, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we decree that, Lord, you will replenish in the name of Jesus. Thank you for all the dignitaries that have been here today, for the mayor that came. Lord, we ask for blessings over the life of the mayor. Let it be so in the name of Jesus. We give you glory and we give you honor. Lord, as we go, go before us, go with us, prosper us in the way. Let it be well with us. And let our lives bring glory to you. That which has been achieved here today, Father, we pray, make it permanent. And for your son that you have put at the forefront of this program, Pastor Festus, we lift him and his wife, the family and the church before you. Father, we pray, uphold them. Lord, strengthen them. Enlarge their tent. Let it be well with them. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Blessed be your holy name. Pray for all our children, that your blessings will be upon the children. All of our children. Lord, our children will be greater than us. Thank you for answers to prayers. We pray for all the pregnant women, that they will have their babies in peace in the name of Jesus. We decree a crisis-free delivery to the glory of your name. And so, Father, we give you glory. Thank you for answers to prayers. Seal us with the blood of Jesus. Let it be well with us. Let our lives bring the glory to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let somebody shout hallelujah. If you are happy to be here, shout hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. 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 The last one has to be the best.
In his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, he's the Father's Spirit.